Hello. Our devotion for today is entitled Feeding Many, and it is taken from the Gospel of John, chapter 6, verses 1 through 15. After this, Jesus went away to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias, and a large crowd was following him, because they saw the signs that he was doing on the sick. Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat down with his disciples. Now the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was at hand. Lifting up his eyes then, and seeing that a large crowd was coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat?" He said this to test Philip, for Jesus knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii would not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little." One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they for so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, about 5,000 in number. Jesus then took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated. So also the fish, as much as they wanted. And when they had eaten their fill, he told his disciples, "Gather up the leftover fragments, that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten. When the people saw the sign that Jesus had done, they said, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." Perceiving then that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself. In verse number 5 in our text for today, Jesus said, "Where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat?" This was a question that Jesus asked his disciples. We should be thankful that he asked it, because it shows the real heart that Jesus has for social situations. And he wants his disciples to share in this interest. An enormous crowd of people had followed him. They were on the hillside. It was spring. The grass and the flowers were blooming on the hills, as they do during this time in Palestine. But there was nothing to eat. A little boy had brought some bread and fish, but it wouldn't be enough. This was the reason Jesus intervened and performed a great miracle. He used God's creative powers. He had refused to use them for his own benefit when he was hungry in the desert for 40 days. But now he did it for the benefit of all of these hungry people. Similarly, it's an equally tremendous miracle when God causes grass to grow for the livestock and plants for man to cultivate, that he may bring forth food from the earth, as it is revealed to us in Psalm 104, verse 14. God performs this miracle for us annually before our very eyes. But we think of it as completely natural. But it would never happen without the Creator's intervention. Jesus fed 5,000 hungry people. No wonder they were so enthusiastic. At last, they found someone who could solve all of their problems. They wanted to lead him away triumphantly, with or without his consent, and make him their leader. But then Jesus withdrew from them to pray. This wasn't his task in the world. He didn't come here to solve the world's problems by producing everything that we may want to eat or appease and satisfy all of our desires. These solutions don't solve our real problems at all. Our real problems are much more profound. They're part of an evil, egotistical, self-glorifying desire that causes new conflicts and sufferings no matter how many material things we acquire. As we already know, problems and conflicts may increase with the acquisition of these things. But this doesn't give us the right to be at peace with ourselves as we sit with our arms crossed amidst suffering and injustice. Whatever can be corrected should be corrected. A Christian has social and political responsibility. Both righteousness and mercy need to be upheld as much and as often as possible on this earth. The church has a particular responsibility to do even more than our society does, especially through our welfare and social work. But the church cannot become what the people wanted Jesus to become, an executor of simply a worldly welfare program. No. You can't receive what Christ has to give as long as you are concerned with protecting your rights and getting the most out of this life. Social issues are important, but there are even more important issues, and neglecting them can have horrible consequences, often already in the here and now, but definitely in eternity. And the way that you resolve them determines everything else. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you put your disciples to the test. You asked them where they could find bread for so many. Are you giving us this test today? And we are afraid, Lord, that we haven't done very well on this test. There are an infinite number of people who need bread, and what we have to give them is insufficient. So often, the staggering number of people in need is just our excuse to do nothing. Forgive us, Lord. Help us think about and do what we can to find enough bread for all to eat and be satisfied. You alone can help us here. Perform a miracle with us all. Make us instruments of your will. Be our King the way you want to be, so that your will guides our hearts, our thoughts, our work, our laws, and, if possible, our society. Lord, perform a miracle with us for your name's sake. In your holy name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. God's blessings. I'll see you next time.